You know, I rarely go to prayer without dancing around. You know, my goodness. Hallelujah. He dances over me. I'm going to dance over him. Hallelujah. Kataramakasha prapaya. Listen, sedate, normal, ordinary, common, not fruits of the Spirit, not evidence that the Holy Ghost is around. Passionate, all that is within you. Huh? Listen, emotional, like joy, love, the glory. Look, you know, it's the religions of demons that want you to be unemotional. It's the religion of demons that want you to cry and suffer and cut yourself and bemoan yourself and everything else around you. We have, praise God, we don't have that. Amen. Woohoo! Hallelujah. 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 Ha ha. Woohoo. Hallelujah. Oh, bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Tabaki stabrabo, Jesus. Babel, mon sitio. Babel, mon supaya. Babel, mon cupane. Irvasirimano. Oh, this wellspring springing, rivers flowing, the glory of God raining down. Hallelujah, I'm surrounded in the fire, baptized in the glory. Everywhere I look around, I see God, I see Jesus, I see the Holy Ghost in power. I see the working of his mighty hand. Hallelujah. I'm gonna pray the same prayer I prayed over my taxi cab driver this morning. I break the power of every mind-blinding spirit that has kept you from understanding the knowledge of Jesus Christ, the Lord. I bring down every stronghold. I smash every demonic power that you may be able to look steadfast in his glory and see and know him. Right now, in the name of Jesus, I unlock the prison door of anything that you may be bound with so that you can now find yourself rejoicing in God, your Savior, living out an abundant life full of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Praise God. You know, it's about time God's people start going around with some power and authority instead of asking a bunch of questions. It's about time we start telling people what to do. God commanded all men to repent, and he told you and I to go with it. Go and command all men everywhere to repent. Go set them free. Don't ask them if they want to be free. Go set them free. Now, whatever happens with their choices that they make after that, well, that's up to each individual's will. But by and large, I'm going to tell you right now, the only reason that people aren't able to see the goodness and the glory of God in the church especially, and then all the way extending out into the deepest dark corner of the world realm, is because of a mind-blinding spirit called the spirit of this world, the spirit of disobedience, the God of this world. And Father, by Christ Jesus, hallelujah, has given us all authority and all power to smash them, to tread upon scorpions. I don't know how you walk on scorpions, but I smash them. That's how I walk on them. I don't know if anybody kind of like just walks on them. You know what I'm saying? You got to have a twist with that walk. I'm telling you right now. Otherwise, something wrong with you. Listen, I'm telling you right now, I stomp myself some rattlesnakes. Okay? Hallelujah. I don't just kind of like just walk over them and hope they don't bite. We make sure their bite is gone. Praise God. So when the Lord was talking these things to us in Luke chapter 10, verse 18, he was giving to us that information, that understanding. Praise God. Hallelujah. That we might behave ourselves the same way with the powers of darkness. God's promise to the seed, you can be seated. God's promise to the seed, hallelujah, is that he would crush the head of the serpent. God's promise to the seed. We didn't say many seeds as of many, but one, singular, Christ Jesus. And today, everybody who's called upon the name of the Lord has had a change in life. Listen, hear me. Hear me. Listen to me now. Listen to me now. Father wants to get your attention. He wants you to come into a place where you just be willing to come and understand the things that He's done for you. There's some things going on in here right now in the spirit. I don't like it. So just get yourself over here into God and quit worrying about your situations with Him and relationships. Get your relationship right with Jesus and all your human relationships to get right too. Hallelujah. I'm a pastor. I fan the place out. I clean the place out. Amen. I'm going to have to fight your devil so I can talk to God. You see me? Can you hear me? Good. Obey me then in Jesus' name. Because all I'm going to do is tell you the word of God. Some people say, well, that's control. It ain't control. I'm here to be a watchman. Listen to me. I'm here to watch over your souls. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, mighty God. Just pray in the Holy Ghost for a minute. Close your eyes, pray in the Holy Ghost for a minute. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, Father's given us this glorious opportunity. You know, we get to see a model in Abraham. Father's given us this glorious opportunity to know Him and becoming more than just, as it were, heir of the world. See, Abraham was made heir of the world because he believed God and was willing to walk with God. And it wasn't just a convenient believing God on Sunday morning. It was leaving everything behind. I mean, really, Father said the same thing to him that Jesus said to the disciples. He said, you got to forsake everything. Come follow me. God said to Abraham, He says, now leave. Go from all that is comfortable to you. Go from everything that is familiar to you. Hallelujah. And come, I'm going to show you a place of inheritance. I'm going to show you a realm where you can live with me in all of the realms of my glory. So he went out not knowing where he was going, but he was seeking a kingdom. He was seeking a kingdom whose builder and maker is God. Not an earthly dwelling, but a heavenly one. Hallelujah. And today, Father has given to us something even far greater than what Abraham. Abraham had a vision of it, and he saw it a long ways off. He had a vision of Christ Jesus, and he saw Jesus afar off. But today, Christ Jesus lives in me. Listen to me. If you still want to continue on in sin, and you still have a desire for sin, you've never been born again, or you're backslidden. I'm preaching the gospel of the Bible. I'm not preaching the gospel of the Roman Catholic Church that says we're all sinners and we want to reach out to the sinners. No. We the saints, the righteousness of God, reaching out to the sinners. Amen. Hallelujah. With all kinds, I don't need to be a sinner to have mercy. All I need is the Holy Ghost to have mercy, because it's a fruit of, hallelujah. Mercy is not a fruit of the sinner. Mercy is a fruit of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Uh-huh. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Father, we just thank you that you bring everything about our lives into a place of complete and total surrender and submission to you. Hallelujah. You know, I was telling my taxi cab driver this morning, I said, you know what the Bible is? He said, I know what the Bible is. I said, you know what the Gospels are? He said, I know what the Gospels are. I said, have you ever read it? He kind of hesitated. I said, I want you to just start reading that. I want you to go home and read this, because I've released you from the powers of darkness that have hindered you up to this point. Huh? So I want you to go home and read it. And everything you read, I just want you to say, yes, Lord, I want that. Yes, God, I want that. Yes, God, I want to know that. And I want to say the same thing to you. Because when Father hears that kind of a heart's cry, when you begin to hunger and thirst after righteousness, that is, righteousness is the behavior of God Almighty. Hallelujah. God gave us the gift of righteousness so that we can learn righteousness. Now listen, He gave us the righteousness of God. We've received the righteousness of God. We haven't received the righteousness of the best and most holy man that ever lived. We've not received the righteousness of that would be maybe categorical compared to Job, or the righteousness that may be categorically compared to Noah, or the righteousness, hallelujah, that may be categorically compared to Abraham. But we have received the righteousness of God. Why? Because God came and moved in on the inside of us. He created us anew and made us everything acceptable unto Himself. Hallelujah. See, Zechariah and Elizabeth began to prophesy. Zechariah said, now being delivered out of the hands of our enemy. And he wasn't talking about the Romans. Listen,
Luke chapter 1, verse 74. Now being delivered out of the hands of our enemies, we may serve God all the days of our life. We may serve him and we may fear him and serve him all the days of our life in righteousness and holiness. What did he see? What did he see? He saw the transformation of men's heart and spirit, the transformation of man's nature to where they became a new creature, a new creation. With God, circumcision counts nothing, and uncircumcision counts nothing. All the religious ideology that you may have is meaningless to God. What he wants is that which he's worked to since the day, and worked for since the day that Adam sinned and transgressed against him, and that it was to bring forth a new creation, a new creature, a new creature. If you're not a new creature, you're not acceptable to God. Galatians chapter 6, verse 15. You're not acceptable to God. If you have not been made the righteousness of God, which is a miracle transformation, salvation is for the people who don't want sin anymore. Salvation is for the people who don't want to live in the hell anymore. Salvation is for the people who want to clean escape all these things that belong to the family of humanity and step over into the family of divinity, the family of Almighty God, the family that Christ Jesus is elder brother of. Oh, come on, people. Come on, man. We have little idea. It takes people way too long to realize all that God has extended to us. We live so far beneath all the glory that he has for us. Few little miracles, signs, and wonders, a little bit more moving of the Holy Ghost than normal. We think we're in full-blown revival. God has granted to us all his fullness. God has granted to us every dimension of that which his glory could manifest and bring. According to his divine power, he's given us everything that pertains to his life, to his life, and to his godliness. I have God Almighty's life. I have God Almighty's godliness. Somebody said, how do you know? Because God said so. The same one that said he came and delivered me and redeemed me and bore my sins at Calvary said, I've given you my life. I've given you my godliness. Why? Because I called you to glory and purity. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm excited about it, I tell you. Hallelujah. Woo. God said to Abraham, said, I'm the sovereign El Shaddai. I'm God Almighty, the sovereign one, the absolute ruler of the universe. That's what El Shaddai means. El Shaddai means God Almighty or sovereign one, absolute ruler, who is God. He said, walk before me and be perfect. Some people are threatened by that. I'm just thrilled. I'm thrilled, hallelujah, that I can be holy and acceptable unto the Father by Christ Jesus, hallelujah, that my garments are spotless, yes, whiter than snow, yeah, though they were blood-stained, it's a difference between white and crimson red, though they were like, the crimson red of a murderous, adulterous, demonic-filled life. God has made them whiter than the snow through the blood of Jesus Christ. Today we want you to put faith in who he is and what he's done. Amen. If you have faith in yourself and not in the Son, your faith is void and vain. If you got a guilty conscience, if you're overwhelmed with shame and condemnation, and you've called upon that name, something broke down in your understanding of the faith that has been given to us by the one who bore our sins at Calvary's cross, who redeemed us by God's divine love and mercy and grace. Hallelujah. So that we now being dead to sin. I'm just dead to it. It's all around me. It's all around me. You know, everywhere we go, we see it, we confront it. When we see it in people, we confront people. We say, you don't have to live that way. You don't have to be like that. You know, we're going to have to make a shift. We've acted too much like salesmen rather than Jesus. We've looked too much like people trying to propagate an ideology rather than ones who are moving in the authority of God, setting people free. And I want to erase all that stuff. I'm tired of people getting inoculated against the gospel, getting vaccinated against the name of Jesus. They've got a wrong conception of Him. They got a wrong idea of Him. And if you begin today to say, Holy Spirit, I want to be so hid away in You that I'm just not even seen anymore. And that really all begins when you quit looking at yourself. You start looking to the author and finisher of your faith. Amen. It begins because you no longer look to your own strength, your own ability, or see yourself after the fashion of humanity or in a human condition. That is a lie. It's a demonic lie. Now, all these preachers talking about the human condition, I have no idea what you're talking about. People think I tell them that in certain situations, and they think that, well, I must be relatively clueless. When they start talking about us, God's people, in the human condition, no idea what you're talking about. I'm no human condition over here. I've got a divine one. I've been born again. God lives on the inside of me. Father God tabernacles in me. He teaches me how to think properly. He teaches me how to choose properly. Hallelujah. If I reach out and touch the unclean thing, He makes it a sting and a shame, and He makes it such deep, dark pain. And by that wonderful, godly sorrow, repentance works in me, so I never want to do it again. Oh, come on. That's a new heart. That's the heart of God. The heart of God hates sin. The heart of God wants nothing to do with ungodliness. The heart of God wants nothing to do with darkness. God will never fellowship with the realms of the demonic power. He'll never partake of sin. And that spirit of the Son is in me. And that spirit of the Father is in me. And that spirit of the Holy Ghost is in me. How? Miracle salvation. I'm not interested in the creeds and doctrines of men. I'm interested in you open up your Bible and read every verse of Scripture and say, Father, I want that. Because I'm telling you, religious powers have intercepted people right, left, and center. Men have learned how to just propagate the doctrines of men and live in the life that men's propagation of the doctrines of men will produce. Religion or religianity, whichever one you like. But God wants to come and bring us over into the family. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. To walk this out with Father in a way, whoo, that I reluctantly sometimes say it because I look at Abraham's obedience. So many people have taken the righteousness which is by faith that was in accounted to Abraham, and they've used it as a means by which they can justify their sin and disobedience. That is so illogical. That is so out of context. For Abraham shows us a model of obedience from the very beginning when he was 75 years old to the very moment in time where he took Isaac up and offered him on the altar at Moriah, probably the exact place where Jesus was crucified. He showed us an obedience. He showed us a perfect obedience that he had been empowered by God to have. There is a visitation for you and I. There is a greater encounter of His glory for you and I. Huh? There's a greater revelation of the habitation that we've been made. See, I get to have a visitation, a greater visitation of Him because I am the habitation. I understand what God did when he gave us, revealed a greater dimension of His glory in Job's life. I understand what God did in part, what He did when He revealed a greater dimension of His glory to Isaiah. But now you and I, though we cannot see it, have been baptized in His very glory, in His very spirit, His very power, and His very presence. And He's come to live on the inside of us, and He's teaching us how to set every step right in its proper place in the ways of life. And if we're simply willing to obey, through obedience there comes greater revelation. Through obedience there comes a greater demonstration of the miracle and all that Father wants to describe. When you begin to obey the Word of God and do what God's Word says, you're going to begin to hear the audible voice more. You're going to have greater understanding of what it means to step into visions and dreams. These aren't fairy tales. He poured out a spirit upon all flesh. And having poured out a spirit upon all flesh, we read in the Bible the consequence and the product of that. Religion can never give you that. Religion will only give you just more sorrow, more suffering, more things to do. But God in His love empowers us. Hallelujah. Spotaranea kesht. It's a shame to some people. It's the glory of God to the Father. Father said, this is my best gift I can give you. Listen, I'm going to give you my best gift. Jesus was all excited, having paid for us to have God's Father's best gift, having suffered, bled, and died, having gone down into hell for 3 days and 3 nights, trembling with excitement that now we get to receive the promise of the Father. And today, people sit all around with a confused look on their face. Well, it's about time somebody step up the pace and start running a bit in the Spirit. I mean, I'm telling you right now, God's called us to move with Him. When He's walking, we're walking. When He's running, we're running. I'm telling you right now. Come on, people. Hallelujah. You got to have to learn how to walk before you can run. Hallelujah. I pray you start walking in the Holy Ghost so you learn how to run in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. I'm going to minister to you a little bit this morning on righteousness, the gift of righteousness. And so I'm going to kind of give you a synopsis or a summary of Romans chapter 3 and 4. Touch down on Romans chapter 5 a little bit. Jump you over into Romans chapter 10. Just kind of take you a little bit on the Romans road of righteousness this morning so that you can understand that God has given us the glorious gift of making us holy and acceptable unto Him. You know, I've already quoted a couple of verses of Scripture for you, such as Luke chapter 1, verse 74 through 75, so you can write that down, so you can go memorize it. I'm going to give you Scripture that you need to eat. I'm going to give you Scripture that you need to eat and consume it. Huh? The way you eat in the Spirit is you read it and you say it. Hallelujah. That's why you eat. It's a little bit different way to halapastakeha. You not let this word depart out of your mouth, but you recite it day and night. Hallelujah. You eat it spiritually by speaking it, praise God. The word of God that goes forth out of your mouth, hallelujah, will be my word, says the Lord, and it will not return void. Now, that's what the Lord says to you today. I know what God said by His servant Isaiah. But I'm telling you what the Lord says to you today, that His word that will go forth out of your mouth, if it is His word, hallelujah, that goes forth out of your mouth, it will not return again unto you void. Hallelujah. But it will accomplish those things which God has purposed. And what God has purposed is that you and I step into all the realms of His provision, all the realms of His blessings, all the realms of those things that belong to His riches. This is what God has purposed for you and I. We live far beneath it because we're preoccupied with other things. I want you to somehow make a break from those other things. People make transitions from jobs. I want you to start making a transition from the earthly realm over into the heavenly realm. I want you to start making a transition of relying on yourself to relying fully and completely on the Holy Ghost. You're going to have to start learning how to let His praise be continually in your mouth. That's one. Somebody said, it's so hard. No, it isn't so hard. You just do it. Just say, thank you, Lord. His praise continually in your mouth. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father, and thank you. Hallelujah. When they canceled my flight last night out of Reno, all I could say is, thank you, Lord, because I didn't understand it. You know, I should be priority here, but the Lord had it all worked out. Huh? We just always walk around praising Him, giving Him thanks. Hallelujah. Sabatareha. Mongande este pretufa. And only eternity would be able to tell why I needed to spend the night in Reno. But I spent the night in the... See, I didn't spend the night in Reno. I spent the night in the kingdom of God. See, I have found the joy and the pleasure in that which God has granted us the privilege to do, to live our lives continually in the kingdom, to be continually about the Father's will. It's not some kind of burden or obligation or heavy yoke to bear. Oh, furabasete da makoshte hala paterina hapaste. Ha, Father has empowered us. Elita Ramonga Eshita, to live free from sickness and disease, to live free from the influences of the demonic power, and when they do come, to have a shield of faith that quenches every fiery dart of the wicked one. Hallelujah. That when we are tried, we know we're right in the battle and the front and confronting powers of darkness, because Father wants to show us how to be more effective at casting them out and having authority over them. If you could just see what's going on, instead of it just being an option for you to choose some lust of the flesh, some lust of the eye, some pride of life, some wicked thing. No, God's giving you an opportunity to show the authority and power that He's placed within you to execute that ability to be an overcomer, to have a power over all unclean spirits, to cast them out. I pray that you'll get a heavenly vision, that you'll have a heavenly understanding, that you'll receive the mind of Christ today. The mind of Christ has been given to you. It's been handed to you in a full volume of the book. Where is it at? Here's the mind of Christ. Somebody said, I want the mind of Christ. Here you go, right here. There's the mind of Christ. And God in His love and kindness caused us to be begotten of His word, born of His word. Listen to me. Hebrews 8:10 says He has written His laws in my mind. People say we've got an unredeemed mind. It's got to be redeemed. Listen, and if it's got to be redeemed, then you the Redeemer. And you have wherewith to glory, keep your crown on in front of Him, okay? Wear your bright and shiny crown. You listen to me. Nonsense. He's a redeemer of all, of everything, of every part of our being. He's left nothing undone. He's nothing left. It is a complete salvation we complete in Him, who is the head of all things. The Scripture says in Hebrews 8:10, concerning this righteousness, in Hebrews 10:16, you can write those down and eat the good word of God and memorize these things, where that they in your heart and in your mouth. Praise God. He says He has established His ways, His statutes, His commandments. He's written them in our heart and in our mind that we may do them. If you have any understanding of the Old Testament, the prophets prophesied that there would come a redemption whereby God would cause us, and literally the word is to make us, walk in His ways, in His judgments, to keep His commandments and His statutes. And I say, are we to look for yet another Redeemer? Is the Redeemer that the prophets of old described, is He Jesus Christ, who is crucified, who is now exalted at the right hand of the Father, Lord of all? I say absolutely so. I say He has fulfilled all things because He said so. He said, now all things are fulfilled. Many people quote it, it is finished. No, it is fulfilled. It is complete. All that the prophets spoke, all that God promised to do from the time that Adam sinned and rebelled against God. Father has restored all things in His only begotten Son, Christ Jesus. People, I want salvation to become more to you than an ideology and more to you than a philosophy, more to you than a religion. I want this Word of God to become living and powerful and effective in your life. The Word of God wants to work mightily with divine power in you that will believe. God has given an opportunity for anyone to change who wants to change. I'm telling you, I'm believing God for such a flow of Holy Ghost conviction through my life. People, my goodness, man, I sit down beside somebody and they start trying to create another hymn in their dress. Hallelujah. And I said anything. I'm telling you, wherever I go, I mean, whatever the situation may be, I want God, the Holy Ghost, His conviction to flow out of me, because He's come to convince men of sin. And He's come to convince men of righteousness. And He's come to convince men of judgment. They're convinced of sin because they didn't believe on Jesus. Because when you believe on the Lord Jesus, all sin is removed. I'm not a sinner saved by grace. I'm a saint saved by grace. Hallelujah. Praise God. You can find the latter in the Scripture, the former you can't find. But that's some people say it so much. You know, somebody speaks a lie so much you think it's truth. Are you listening to me? Huh? God moves in mysterious ways His wonders to perform. Huh? A poet said that, not God. And we could go on and on that people can quote these words of men. It's amazing to me. How much word of men, how many ideas of men, doctrines of men, sayings of men, God's people can quote. But when they're pressed to speak out the word of God, it becomes a little bit of a challenge. Today, I want you to just get the word of God in you. I want you to know who He's made you. I want you to see the gift of salvation that is presented to you. Jesus said, I have a gift for you, and you won't be thirsty for the world anymore. Huh? I have a gift for you. It will cure all your addiction. It will cure all your uncleanness. It will cure all your problems. It will cure all your issues. It will cure all your affinity towards the realms of the demonic. It will be a wellspring springing up of the very life of God. Hallelujah. It's eternal life. I'm going to take the salvation that Jesus is offering, not that men is interpreting based upon his own experience and the own blindness of his heart. I want what God said in his word. I want you to grab a hold of what God said in his word. If you will, I'm telling you right now, you'll have the miracle of it. You'll find a place of communion with Father in that wonderful realm of prayer, that wonderful realm of conversation, to where all of a sudden you discover the rivers, where just all of a sudden you just wake up in the morning and you swept away in prayer, and you ain't time to go to prayer, you swept away in prayer. Are you listening to me? You're caught away in a realm of glory, and divine gushings are coming out of you, and you know things are shifting around. And in that place, you now speak whatever it is that you want to speak, and you ask whatever you want to ask, and Father does it. See, people want to take, God made the impossible, the supernatural, the miraculous. Getting Him or having Him do something on our behalf as simple as asking. He said, whatever you ask, I will do it. when people try to ask out of the realm of a purely human understanding, out of a realm of something that is not, that's more self than it is anything else. Are you listening to me? Jesus had a self. He was at a good self. Jesus had the best self that ever lived. How many of you believe that Jesus had the best self that ever lived? He did. He had a better self than Adam ever had. Are you listening to me? He had a better self than any man that has ever made. And he said, I deny myself. And he said, you must do the same. People always talking about something. When people are compromised and they believe somehow there's some iniquity on the inside of them, they're never going to understand this freedom that is in Christ Jesus. They're never going to understand it. Until you realize that this is the way it works out. When you've been made a new creation and you receive the wellspring of life and the gift of salvation, the greater one lives on the inside. And there is this there's this interface of all that is in the world, the lesser one that lives on the outside. Are you listening to me? Say, greater one on the inside, lesser one on the outside. Hallelujah. And he comes with all the forces of everything that he enslaves men with. All the realms of the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. And all we got to do is be willing to stand in Christ Jesus. All we got to recognize is, wait a minute, God's tabernacling in me. Man, all that stuff is out there, but I just blow it up in Jesus' name. I explode it in Jesus' name. I'm dead to it. I'm alive to God. See, I've been made the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Today, I'm asking a question. Have you been made the righteousness of God? I mean, has God taken his righteousness and reproduced it on the inside of you, making you his righteousness? Yes. In other words, you an expression of his conduct in life. Yes. Huh? Amen. Hallelujah. Some of you are reluctant. A couple of you got a half a shout there. Huh? Most people are on the nod basis only. Come on, people. I want you to get radical about what God has done. Yes. I want you to believe the gift that God has given us in his Son. Hallelujah. He said, if you'll just recognize who I am, I'm the one that all the prophets talked about, where I'd bring forth a whole new dimension of life within man that would be able now to fulfill all that Father had ever planned. Listen to me. Hallelujah. That's what he said. If you recognize who I am and the gift that I have to give. Hallelujah. You would ask me and I'd give it to you. You would ask me and I would give it to you. You would ask me and I would give it to you. Listen, there's everybody on the planet recognizes the things that they've done haven't satisfied them. Everybody on the planet recognizes that the things that's going on in their life has brought shame and sorrow, causes them to lay awake late in the night. It causes all kinds of death and destruction and broken relationship that can't ever be fixed. Jesus Christ has come and said, I want to show you a new way to live. I want to give you life, and I want to give it to you more abundantly. I want to show you, ooh, hallelujah, how to walk in the light instead of how to walk in the darkness. I want to say, ooh, rabasa, how to walk in love instead of hate. Habrasateya, how to walk in goodness instead of badness. Praise the name of Jesus. You know, in Romans chapter 3, I want you to go ahead and open up your Bibles, and I want you to just go ahead and open 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 21, 22. Just stare at that, 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Go there, turn there, and stare at chapter 5, verse 21, forgive me. Just go there, stare at chapter verse 21. Let's just look at it together, and then I kind of walk you back through this stuff. And he says, for he has made him to be the sin offering for us. Okay, he's made him to be the sin offering. Somebody said that you're adding a word. No, I'm not. Chata in the Hebrew language always means sin offering. If you just wanted to translate it for what it is, chata, it would just simply be translated sin. But we know by context, every time you see chata, it is usually a Levitical context. It means sin offering. It doesn't mean sin. Bring now a ram for a sin. No, bring a ram now for sin offering. Bring a bull now for a sin. No, bring a bull for a sin offering. Bring now a lamb for a sin. No, bring a lamb for a sin offering. Bring now two turtle doves. No, for a sin. No, for a sin offering. Ha-ha means sin offering. Here, this same word is translated baharmatia in the Greek language. Okay? And it means sin offering. He wasn't made a sinner. He was made sin offering. Praise God. He was made a sin offering. And then somebody said, well, you know, if that's true, then tell me where another verse of scripture, just give me at least one more verse of scripture to help support that. Okay? Listen, I'll give you another verse of scripture to help support that. Are you with me? Yes. He bore our sins in his own body on the tree. Hallelujah. He bore our sin in his own body on the tree. What is that? Sin offering. That's the transference of sin into the goat, or transference of sin into the ram, or transference of sin into the bull. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
I just want you to understand what God says in light of what his word says, rather than trying to sit around and figure everything out. People are, theologians are lost in the woods, man. Don't follow them around. You're walking in circles, because some of them got a shorter leg than others, and it's a real small circle. You know what I'm saying? I just kind of, you know, what, yeah, that's right. Everybody's got one short, you know, according to the theory, everybody's got one leg a little bit shorter than the other. And so they end up walking in a big circle when you walk lost in the woods. Anybody ever feel like they're walking in a circle and they're not making any headway? Oh, come on now. Listen, you're lost in the woods. We want you to see the grandiose plan of God. Recognize what redemption is all about. See the big picture of what God did for us. Then find yourself in him. People want to I watch people wrestle. What does it mean? What is Paul talking about when he's talking about faith, the faith of Jesus Christ? What is he describing? He's talking, come on, give me a break. He's talking about what it means to be born again because of what Jesus did for us. That's the faith, to become a new creature through calling upon the name of the Lord Jesus. Jesus highlighted the faith in John chapter 3. He made it very clear, didn't he? He says to Nicodemus, he said, you must be born from above. Now, really, Peter in 1 Peter used the word or phrase born again. He said we're born again by the resurrection. We're born again by the resurrection. Begotten again by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Really, born again by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. He also used the same word when he said we are born again by the word of God. Begotten again by the word of God. So born again unto a living hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, begotten or born again of the word. And then the word of God, Peter, of course, all of you know the verse of scripture. Maybe some of you don't. 1 Peter 1:23, begotten again, hallelujah. Born again of the word, the incorruptible seed of God, the incorruptible seed, the word of God, which lives and abides forever. Wave your hands at me if you know what I'm talking about. I don't want you to think I'm making this up as I go. But over in John chapter 3, he uses a different word. He says, born from above. Hallelujah. Means the same thing. He's just directing us the fact that when we're born again, we literally become the issue of God the Father, just like he became the issue of God the Father. Oh, my, a couple of faint amens and about rest of the people don't even understand that this is the very foundation of the faith because they've been listening to a bunch of other stuff. I'm telling you right now, this is so great a salvation. Hallelujah. 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 Born again by the, born from above by the Holy Ghost, literally becoming this one who Christ Jesus has been formed in. I mean, Jesus said, unless a seed die, is sown into the earth and dies, it abides alone. But when it dies, it brings forth much fruit. Does does a tomato seed bring forth oranges? Listen, come on. A tomato seed will bring forth tomatoes. Hallelujah. A wheat seed is not going to bring forth cucumbers, okay? It is going to produce after its own kind. He's talking about how he reproduced himself in you and me. That is the new man. Christ formed in you and me. Christ Jesus, that which is one with him, born by the Holy Ghost, where the very Spirit of God not only lives on the inside of us, but literally a new spirit we've been given, and a new heart, hallelujah, reproduced after Christ Jesus, our Savior. Not an old man, you know, trying to become a new man. Not someone still stuck in the birth canal. I mean, completely given, hallelujah, this new life. Praise God, up, moving around, walking around, growing, hallelujah. Moving in Him, praise God. Hallelujah. All by what he's done for us. His unspeakable gift, the gift of righteousness, the gift of abundant life, the gift of a wellspring springing, the gift of rivers of his very existence flooding out of us. People, if you give yourself all day to your stuff, you're never going to realize it. You will only have a concept of a fictional idea about God. You're going to have to participate. You're going to have to begin to allow what God has placed on the inside of you to be developed and grow and mature, hallelujah, into all the fullness of a fully matured man, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Katarasea pohota. Hoteshitoramahatasia. Hallelujah. That's why there's neither male nor female, you know. But we all in Christ Jesus. Praise God. Somebody said, don't let a woman speak in church. I said, don't let a man speak either. Amen. Praise God. Are you listening to me? I'm going to mess your hair up in your religion. I'm going to mess your hair up, and I'll make you look at yourself all messed up. All messed up in all these doctrinal ideas that amount to nothing. While people have not understood how to live out the new life and overcome sin, all stuck in something so peripheral, people sit around arguing about the Trinity instead of experiencing Him. Come on. People arguing about whether the Spirit of God comes on you and remains, or whether the Spirit of God comes on you and lift off, and they have never had either. You know what I'm saying? Come on. It just come on you and lift off like it did in the Old Testament, or does it come upon you like Jesus and remain? And they sit and argue back and forth and know nothing about the relationship. That's religion. And I like to say religion because it sounds like a drug. And I like to say religianity because it sounds like, you know, Christianity. Are you listening to me? Christianity is to be those who are like Christ. Hallelujah. When you say you're a Christian, you mean you saying, I'm just like Christ. And by context, Christ Jesus. Praise God. Hallelujah. Living in the Spirit, walking in the Spirit. Somebody said, well, how? You know, I just don't feel I deserve it. No, you don't, but He gave it to you. See, He imputed righteousness. He accounted righteousness, praise God, even when, like Abraham was in his uncircumcision, He accounted righteousness and said, okay, I'm going to extend to you the ability to be one with me. I'm going to extend the ability for you to know me. I'm going to extend the ability for you to approach unto me, because the wicked, those who are lost, those who do not know Him, cannot approach unto Him. He said, do not draw near to me. Don't get near me, because you're other than I am. And here, in this particular place where Abraham was willing to believe God, He accounted it to him for righteousness, because he was willing to obey and do what God said, even though it seemed, you know, beyond all possible measure to do. And he wasn't even baptized in the Holy Ghost. And he didn't even have a new spirit. But you know what he received? He received the empowerment and ability which God gives that comes with His word. Somebody said, how is Abraham able to do what he did? Because there's an empowerment that comes with God's word when we obey it. The Old Testament and New Testament. How was Moses able to do what he did without having a new spirit and being baptized in the Holy Ghost? Because there's an empowerment with His word, those who will believe it, that gives us the divine ability to do it. God never asks us to do anything that He doesn't empower us to do it. And I'm telling you right now, with that, none of us have an excuse on that day to say, oh God, you understand. I was living in San Diego at the time, and you recognize all the wickedness that was about me. I mean, we were being flooded by it continually. Dear people, I'm telling you right now, I feel that my biggest concern for most people is this, that they've had more of it. I don't think it's here. I don't believe it's here at all. But they've had more of an impact of a real influence from the realms of the satanic than they've had of an impact of a real influence from an encounter with the living God. And I'm not going to be willing to stand by and just watch it be just some sort of an encounter with the living God. Hey, I love every dimension. I love His love. I love His joy. I love His peace. And I, you know, it's fine. I want everybody to understand that. But there's a greater encounter with Him than that. People say, I had someone email me last night, and they said, please tell me that there's more to God than this. If someone had been walking with the Lord for a long time, please tell me that there is a realm that I can step into that goes beyond all that I'm presented in the church. And he's in a very good church. As far as that goes, he's in a church that, you know, they have no small amount of the manifestation of joy and other good things in God. I said, oh, what you're doing is you're telling me that you want to live vicariously through somebody else's anointing. What you're telling me is that you want to receive all that you can have personally from the context of the foundation that the church places you in. No, what you're asking for is that which only you, one-on-one with God, can step into, where you take all that has been laid out and you lay hold on God and you touch heaven so heaven can touch you. It isn't about you getting saved something extra from me. It's about you getting and receiving that which you need in God that has been supplied to me to get you established in a place where you begin to seek God with all your heart. You begin to find the joy and the beauty and the splendor of fellowship that comes in prayer, the intimacy that comes by walking out with God. What this man was wanting, what this preacher was wanting, was he was wanting something that will only come to pass because he's willing to sow his life into the kingdom, because he's willing to go after God. It's something that he can only receive based upon his individual pursuit of Father and reception of what Father wants to give. Most of what Father has for you is going to be discovered one-on-one. You're going to get baptized in the Holy Ghost in church, and that's beautiful. But the development of that and the splendor and the glory of it and the beauty of it and the extremes of it are going to be found because you go after him in prayer. You go after him in hungering and thirsting after righteousness. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm looking at some of your faces and I can tell you I understand what's going on in your life by the expression upon your face. You cannot hide. You cannot hide. I can see the concern. I can see the worry. I can see the doubt. I can see the complacency. I can see lukewarmness. I can see fire. I can see hunger. God allows us to see it. Why? Because he's made us those people who are able ministers of the word by the Spirit. And so I'm not here to shame anybody or to point anything out. I'm just here telling you, I'm announcing to you the good things of God, but I'm going to tell you right now, you do not want to serve God based upon a false pretense. You want to serve God based upon truth, and his word is truth. And you want to have in your life the results of that which Father brings by his Holy Spirit and describes fully in his word. God extended to you righteousness. When we were yet dead in our trespasses and sin, he commended his love towards us. Huh? God, Jesus, shed his blood, not for our sins only, but for the sins of the whole world. The Holy Ghost, the Spirit of holiness, who is totally other than all humanity, has now come and moved upon all flesh and moving upon all men. And that is God extending his mercy and extending his grace to be willing to come and interact with us, to become that one who touches us, accounting us, even though we're not worthy of it, accounting us worthy, accounting us holy, accounting us acceptable, so that we can respond and then receive the gift of righteousness, the impartation. Not an accounting, not an imputation, but an impartation. So it's not now the Holy Ghost there hovering over you, brooding over you, calling you, reaching out to you, as the Spirit of the Lord reached out to Abraham when he was there, an alien from God himself. Uncircumcised amongst idolaters, God imputed righteousness or counted righteousness to him by one act of belief. And here we now step into a place where God the Holy Ghost comes and lives on the inside. Where literally all that you read in the Old Testament about the sacredness of the inner, what we call the inner sanctum or the holies of holies, has now come to dwell in our hearts and in our lives. People draw back from this because it's too glorious. But when you begin to accept it and understand it, and you recognize I'm no longer unclean, I'm no longer profane. And it's not some kind of a positional ideology that keeps you going on having a lust for and a desire for other things that are contrary to heaven and contrary to God. Huh? It is this rather what happens in your life is you recognize, wait a minute, I am sacred. God made my life. I'm sacred. Hallelujah. I'm sacred to him. I'm bought with a price. I'm his purchased possession. God's tabernacling on the inside of me. Every time I think of that through the day, I give a hoop. I give a hallelujah. I holler out, hallelujah. Thank you, mighty God. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. My garments, they spotless. My God, if I sin, all I do is confess my sin. He's faithful and just. If. Man, everybody wants it to be when. They come to salvation. Somebody comes to salvation, and we just want to leave them. We want to leave them in their bondage. I want to see people get delivered. I'm not going to tell anybody that they saved until I see the fruits of salvation. I got to bring forth the fruits. Hallelujah. Listen, believe me, I qualify the Holy Ghost and the name of Jesus above all other things. If somebody calls upon the name of the Lord Jesus, they will be saved. But many people can just say that. Do they believe in the heart? Do they really want to change? There is a deliverance that comes. Then they've got to go to the water and be baptized. Because I've watched this, okay? Some of you have too, especially some of you from India, okay? Some of you maybe from Buddhism, or some of you from Judaism, or some of you from Islam. People just say, they'll say in these various different religions, they'll say, all you want to repeat after me concerning the Lord Jesus Christ, but as soon as we want to go to the water and be baptized, a sorting out comes. Wait a minute, I can't do that. See, I've seen people baptized in the Holy Ghost before they ever called upon the name of Jesus. Huh? So the Lord can mess it all, mess up your perfectly scaled out plan perfectly. You know, he can mess it all up. People get baptized in the Holy Ghost, and then we just go ahead and let him call upon the name of Jesus and then go baptize them in water, but they are already ahead. So it doesn't have to be incremental, stepwise. You know, God do it whatever way. That's what he did to Cornelius' house. I've got a scriptural model for all of this. Are you listening to me? While they yet heard Peter speak, nobody even said Jesus yet. While they yet heard Peter speak, they were all baptized in the Holy Ghost. Are you with me? Hallelujah. As Philip was preaching Jesus to the eunuch, he was just preaching Isaiah 53. I can't find water baptism in Isaiah 53. But the eunuch heard this: what does hinder me from being baptized? Nothing, so long as you believe with all the heart. The examination is always going down. But I found that people will maybe, I found that if there's any holding back, water baptism may bring it out. But you know, during the days of Philip, his ministry in Samaria in Acts chapter 8, you know, Simon was beholding the wonders that he did, was with him, received Jesus, baptized in water, huh? But he got sorted out at baptism in the Holy Ghost. People don't, they can't, they've got a roadblock. They can't move into baptism in the Holy Ghost. Receiving the baptism of the Holy Ghost is so easy. When people can't receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost, I know there's a roadblock. The roadblock may be just religious ideology, fear that Satan sets up, or it's sin and iniquity. It's one of the three. It could be one of four or five too, but I don't know. You know, the bottom line is they're just kind of laying out some general things to you. It could be six or seven different things. Huh? But what does it allow me to know? It allows me to know I need to help some people. I need to get them out of the mess they're in. When people aren't growing, when they're not maturing in the gifts of the Spirit, because God has extended to us the heirship and co-inheritorship. He's extended to us all that He Himself has in His mercy. He has extended it to us by His goodness and by His grace, making us the righteousness of God, giving us the Holy Ghost, filling us with every good thing that He has, so that as the floods that comes out, floods. I'm not willing to be without floods. Somebody said, why is it that sometimes I can, you know, really flow in the Holy Ghost and other times that I can't? Because that other times you're not willing, you're willing to be without. Uh-oh. It's because other times you're willing to be without. Other times, the Lord's allowing you just to face maybe some of the hindrances, maybe some of the issues, some things He wants you to press in for so that He can reveal more things to you, and you're willing to stop short of it. And it just shows you doubt and unbelief in your life. Because when you recognize you can have a move of God anytime you want it, and you want one all the time, you're going to have a move of God all the time. Amen. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Going to Kerala. Sibakarasateridia. Soon. Hallelujah. Kitaraman Jessica Teresa, Malevre Dekeya, Mondefe Sisuto Rishika, Manje Guste. I want to convince you today that God has brought a change for everybody who will obey the gospel. Ande beste e pritokoshti. And He's got a mosevreya. He's got a destibritofoni me. And He's got a vested interest in you and me. And in that vested interest, He's there with long suffering, pleading with us. Pleading with us to come, pleading with us to go ahead and receive all that He has for us. Looking back there, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21. He who knew no sin became sin for us. Hallelujah. That we might be made the righteousness of God in Him. Go and look with me back in Romans chapter 3 real quick. Just look at a couple of verses of Scripture. Just highlight a couple of these things. And, you know, I've watched as people are hung up on things that Isaiah prophesied over a backslidden Israel who was bent on doing evil, who were stout to walk in rebellion against God. And he said, and he cried out prophetically concerning those things that Paul writes in Romans chapter 3, beginning in verse 9 and all the way through verse 19. They totally misunderstand it. And then they try and take and apply that to the redeemed child of God. That is, has no application. What Isaiah said, what the psalmist said, what the prophet said, who is speaking out in the Psalms, in Psalms 14, in Psalm 16, Psalms 42, these other places, that these quotes that we read here from verses 9 through 20 are derived from. This is, God's not talking about the redeemed person. He's saying, listen, I don't care if you say that you're a Jew, that you are born of the seed of Abraham. He's saying, both to both Jew and Gentile, you both in need of a redeemer. You both in need of Savior. There, you have forsaken the right way. You have turned aside and gone after iniquity. And then he begins to describe the general population. He's not describing everyone. He's not describing everyone. Even in the Old Testament, he's not describing everyone. Does anybody know that I'm telling the truth?
Yes. Yes.
Then you have to know the verses of Scripture. Because Job was righteous. God said so. So all of a sudden, you have to re-understand what it means that there's none righteous, no, not one. Because Job was righteous. Noah was righteous. Huh? Listen to me. Are you listening?
Yes.
We can go on. Moses was called righteous. Hallelujah. Daniel was called righteous. Huh? There's three men called perfect as well. So you have to understand the context. The context was against a rebellious people. They're already under the judgment of God. And he's telling them, remember, Jesus said, as the prophet Isaiah said, seeing you shall not see, hearing you shall not hear, and neither will your heart be able to understand unless you should be converted. It was a judgment that came upon them by the prophet Isaiah. Jesus re-announced the judgment in Matthew chapter 8. Paul also referred to the judgment in Acts, I believe, is verse chapter 28. Are you with me? Seeing you should not see, speaking to the people of Israel who want to be all boastful about the fact that they don't need anyone because they have Moses. They don't need anyone. They don't need any salvation because they have Abraham. No, Paul's just helping every one of them to understand that we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God, that every man stands in need of salvation. And in the midst of this, so people go around and just strip God's people of divine power and ability. They strip God's people of this holiness. They strip God's people of this righteousness. They strip God's people of this power to stand in Christ's stead. I want to empower you as God has empowered us with all the realms of the Holy Ghost, with all the realms of the new creation, with all the realms of Father's own presence, to go ahead now and live out a life in heaven as witnesses to all the world around us of what it's like to walk with God, of an authority that is able to set people free from the bondage of sin. Because I'm telling you right now, until you understand these things, you're going to be conflicted and compromised, and you're never going to know the life of the overcomer. And that's probably the worst possible state you could be in. Because the Lord Jesus said, if you overcome as I've overcome, then you'll sit down with me in my throne as I sat down with my Father in his throne. Today, we're just pleading with you. Today, you're sitting in this place because God in his mercy and his love and his grace, he brought you here. Every one of you have different things that you've come from in different past, different experiences, different events, different issues you're dealing with, areas where you're not willing to yield to God and go on with God. Every one of you dealing with different kinds of doubts and unbeliefs. But I'm going to tell you right now, I want to set your feet upon a straight path so that you'll begin to walk in the faith and you'll begin to experience the exponential kind of growth that Father's produced and made available to us. People, Abraham was seen and known as a man who was a prince of the Most High God. It's time now that we begin to take up a glorious opportunity, a mantle of an inheritance that we have received in Christ Jesus, and begin to live this thing out with the divine authority that has been given to us in Christ Jesus, the Father has given to us, that we have right now in the Holy Ghost. You don't have to live the life that you've been living. I don't care what life you've been living up to this point. I don't care if you've basically been over the top in the things of the Spirit. You had great revelation, in the abundance of revelation in God. Father's purpose to take you over into all of his fullness. So that you and I will know with all saints what is the height, the breadth, the length, the depth. We have this privilege because we received the gift of righteousness. We received the gift of righteousness by faith. So if you can get over verses 9 through 20 and recognize it has nothing to do with you, praise God. Huh? That's once what you were. You were. There's no man who is no man's person is acceptable to God. I deal with secular humanism all the time. People say, well, I try to be good. And I say, well, that's not good enough. Well, what do you mean? It ain't good enough. Your good is still filthy before God. And you know, then people are like, that's fighting words. No, that's it's because you bound with secular humanism. I'm going to just tell you like it is. Huh? But I'm going to tell you also that if you call upon the name of Jesus, you'll be good enough. You'll be holy and acceptable unto God. And it's not something that's positional. It's something that we're empowered to be. I'm empowered. Jesus said, be perfect, even as your Father in heaven is perfect. That's what he said. And some people are intimidated by that. I'm like, stoked. God says, be pure. Jesus said, John said, be pure even as he is pure. I'm going, I'm empowered. No, come on. He said, everyone who does righteousness is righteous even as he is righteous. I mean, see, when you begin to get empowered by it, you're going to start jumping around. You go, woo! Ah! Hallelujah! Satan hath no hold upon me. No, Satan had no hold upon me because he went down and he proclaimed with a loud voice to the spirits in prison, release them, release them. And then he put that same voice on the inside of me, release them. Hallelujah. No, when you think about the reality that we've been made, the righteousness of God in him, and then you go over to John chapter 3, and you stare at verse 7 for a couple of years, praying in the Holy Ghost to get it. And you say, you hear him say, everyone that does righteousness is righteous, just like he is righteous. Then you go, my goodness, what God has done for me. My, look at the empowerment that he filled me with when he filled me with his spirit of holiness. When he filled me with the spirit of the living God. When he filled me with the very life of Jesus Christ. Hello, people. It's about time you stop bearing the image of men. If Adam's disobedience would have such a terrible consequence, how much greater will the obedience of Christ Jesus abound unto righteousness in our life? Come on, I'm just so interested in some people getting into faith. Instead of skirting around it, you know, just feeding off of men's pabulum. Huh? Somebody said, oh, we're just feeding the sheep milk over here. No, you're feeding the sheep something far from milk. I say you feed anything that's not the Word of God, not the water of the Spirit, it's poison. It's destroying men. It's blinding them. You know how many people sit in church today and their confession is that they're unrighteous? Did you know that that is anti-Word and it's anti-Christ? For with the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. And with the heart, man believes that he's righteous. Hello. 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 Man, somebody starts dancing that stuff around me, I'm telling you, fire. The zeal of the Lord eats me up. I just say, you unrighteous, but I'm righteous. You sick, but I'm healed. You poor, but I'm rich. Hallelujah. You blind, but I see. You naked, but I'm clothed. Because I believe what Christ Jesus said about me. I believe what God has said about me. And you're trying to impose upon me what you believe about me. And what you believe about yourself. And I'm going to tell you right now, I know something else about you because of your confession. I don't care if you're a preacher or someone all the way to the stinkiest pew. You got sin going on in your life that you're trying to condone. That's all it is. You got iniquity that you do not want to repent of, that you love the wages of unrighteousness more than God. You're just like Balaam. Evil, it's about time somebody knows how to speak by the Spirit of the Lord. It's about time somebody knows how to speak the truth in love, who knows how to declare these things which God has spoken and he's revealed. I don't care how famous the person is. I don't care how great they are. I don't care how big their church is. If the Word is not the Word of God, there is no truth in them. I just want to hear the Word. You know, I find people all the time. I'm in different places, and I'm like, I don't even know hardly the town I'm in, or the place I'm in, or where they're really going. Especially on an airplane, where they're going to get dropped off at. I don't know what kind of churches they're going to find. I just make sure I tell them very clearly: don't get involved in religion. Go read your Bible. Go read it. Listen. Do yourself a favor. You're going to spend eternity in hell if you don't listen to me. Doesn't matter whether they believe or not. They can say, I don't believe that. Fine. You know what? They're just trying to, they're lying to themselves and they're lying to me. I know they believe it. Huh? Are you listening to me? Just say it. You're going to spend eternity in hell. Do not forsake your opportunity to know the truth. Just read the Bible. Read the Bible. And then say to every scripture, and I'm saying this to you, read the Bible. In every scripture, say, Lord, I want that. And I'm going to tell you right now, God is going to produce it. And what's going to happen is God's got his people in every city. God's got his people in every town. God's got his people in every village. And you start crying out to God like that, and you're gonna fall out of your car right into the place where God's people are meeting. Huh? You're gonna get lost and end up asking directions from the place you're supposed to be going to church. You know, God knows how to hook his people up. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I tell you right now, you may not understand it. You got hooked up by God to get here. You got hooked up. I mean, you got to have some kind of serious desire for truth on the inward parts. Hallelujah. Yeah. And I'm. And the more you believe the word of God rather than the word of men, the faster the growth will be. For much of the things that God has to do with his people is to, as it were, break out of them, destroy out of them the chaff of false prophets. He has to destroy out of them, break off of them, the rocks supplanted in their life by those who speak the words of men rather than the word of God. Yeah. What is the chaff says to the wheat? What is the chaff to the wheat says the Lord? Huh? Is not my word like a fire? Did it burn up the chaff? And what is he talking about? He's talking about false prophets. Somebody said, oh, how do I know a person is a false prophet? They saying something that is contrary to the word of God. Amen. And I watch God's people be a false prophet to themselves, right, left, and center. They're coming out of their mouth. They're speaking stuff over their own life and about themselves and about others that has absolute anti-God and it's anti-Christ and it's anti-word. Huh? It's about time you start being a true prophet to yourself. Amen. It's about time that you start blessing yourself with the words of your mouth. And somebody said, how do I get those right words? Right here. He has taken his word and he has put it in my mouth. I mean, that was the highest declaration that God could give to a prophet in the Old Testament. And it was just a few men that were allowed to have that. Okay, the word of the Lord either came to them, or, which is the most situations, the word of the Lord came unto them. But as to Jeremiah, I have put my word in your mouth. Today, we can say, he has put his word in my mouth. Hallelujah. His word is in my mouth and in my heart so that I may speak it. Hallelujah. That I may speak it. That I may speak it by the Spirit. All the heavenly language is really about is teaching us how to speak by the Spirit instead of our own understanding. How to speak out of the realms of divine power and glory instead of out of the realms of our own human interest. Oh, yeah. For the confession of your mouth creates, as it were, makes salvation. Hallelujah. For the confession of his mouth is made unto salvation. There's several ways to translate that. For the confession of your mouth, that which you speak. It's about time you start walking around saying, praise God for what you've made me, Lord, instead of poor me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's about time that you start understanding. You're walking out there. There's the God of this world. He's spirit that now works in the children of disobedience. You're under the authority of God Almighty, creator of the heavens and the earth. The spirit that now works in the children of obedience. And when you go out there, all around you are things that you need to be saying, yea, they'll walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Because it is the valley of the shadow of death. Everywhere you turn, there are things that are there set up to lure you, to entice you. God tells us, people believe that there's no war. You know what? That's so stupid. Of course there's a war. Otherwise, you wouldn't be fighting the good fight of faith. Of course there's a war. Huh? Otherwise, you would need to be strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of his might and take on yourself the whole armor of God. The whole armor of God. The armor of God is talked about, but revealed concerning what Father has as his own ability, his own, as it were, his own protection, as it were, his own instruments of war by the prophets, especially the prophet Isaiah. And he says, then that was far before the Roman Empire. So forget about some Roman armament describing to you us the whole armor of God. But take unto yourself the whole armor of God. Be strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of his might. And take unto yourself the whole armor of God. Amen. That you may be able to stand against all the devices and tricks of the wicked one. Because we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against spiritual wickedness in high places. Now Father wants to teach us about heaven, a mind, a thinking realm, of salvation, and what it means to be completely delivered from all that is in the world, and no longer under the power or the authority of the prince of this world, but walking around in divine ability to tread upon scorpions and serpents and over all the power of the enemy, to have all authority to cast out all unclean spirits, to deal with all unclean spirits, where the Satan cannot touch us, the wicked one cannot touch us. Amen. Listen, I tell you, I most people today in churches don't even understand that what I'm describing to you is the Word of God. And it is so sad. And that's why they're defeated. That's why they live constantly being compromised by wickedness and sin and self-interest. I want you to grab a hold of what God has empowered you and I to be, that we can understand how to have our feet shod with the good news. That's just where that's our whole purpose of living, I mean, if you're still ashamed of Brava de Karanamoshtapara in a public place, you got yourself a problem. Ashamed of the Holy Ghost. It's time to matter. Well, I don't want to offend anybody. You just offend anybody anyways. You know what I'm saying? If you offend people, if you knew how everybody feels about you, you would never leave your house. Get over it. I mean, you're trying to impress people. You'll impress them. Begin to set them free from their sickness and their disease. Praise God. Start flowing in the life-giving flow that has been provided for you and me so we can go set the captives free. They'll get impressed. Hallelujah. I've never seen anybody too overwhelmed. Well, I'm just going to shut this down and try to come up with something good to say to somebody. Huh? When praise is bubbling out of your innermost being, go ahead and sing. I don't care where you're at. Because that's what God says. God's going to break somebody's yokes off into that song. Yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's going to get somebody's attention. Yeah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. It's going to get somebody's attention. Hallelujah. God is so good. Hallelujah. I mean, just reacting to everything anybody says everywhere you go with a shout of praise. God, God's so good to me. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And start being who we're supposed to be instead of we're under a gag order. That's being influenced by demon spirits. That's you under the authority of this prince of the power of the air, trying to keep you from being a witness of who God has made you. Listen, birds were made to fly, fish were made to swim, you were made to praise. Amen. Hallelujah. Are you listening to me? Ka-ta-ra-sha-ta-ya. Hallelujah. Pra-ta-ya. Hallelujah. Say thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. God said this. He said that I walk even as he walks. He says that I am even as he is in this world. Hallelujah. Come on, I want you to grab a hold of this now. I don't want you to draw back. I don't want you to continue to live your life. Neither do I want to see people confessing this and continuing on living their own life. This is for the hungry. This is for the thirsty. This is for the needy. These are for the people who pressing into the kingdom of God. Kingdom of God suffers violence, and the violent take it by force. You know what that means? You banging on the door. Get up! Get up and get for me that which I need to walk just like you. Get up! Get up! Wake up in there! That's what he said in Luke chapter 11. He's looking for some people who got boldness, who are not willing to live without it. They go to banging. It sounds like it's silent. Sounds like God's sleep. You bang louder. That's what ask, seek, and knock means. That's the context in which it's given. Wake up in there. Get up. I need something. You're not going to get up because he's your friend. And the Lord loves to use these hyperboles to drive home a point, whether it's the unrighteous judge and a widow, whether it's the friend who's next door neighbor who needs something from his friend, and his friend's already asleep. He goes to banging. Get up in there! He will not rise for his friend, but because of his shameless boldness. Amen. Because he's demanding it. Huh? Because he's not going to stop knocking. Well, it's banging. That ain't even loud enough. I tell you right now, I know how to bang. I know you know how to bang too. Especially if it's your house and you can't get in. You can't get in. Are you listening to me? And you know somebody said, I know what you're doing. Hey! Uh-huh. Are you listening to me over here? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Especially if it's a close friend of yours. Huh? You can bang. You can bang to the point of breaking windows now. Come on, people. Come on. Father's looking for some people who hunger and thirst after righteousness. In other words, God's looking for some people who want the kingdom now. God's looking for people who don't want to live another day without his glory. Hallelujah. Who don't want to live another day without a greater manifestation of his power in his life. Listen, we've received the life of Christ. We no longer live. It's Christ who lives. We need to start getting into the realms of what that really means. The anointing is nothing more than the display of the life of Jesus, the life and power of Jesus. Somebody said, I want to increase in the anointing. You want to increase in the display of the life and power of Jesus. I need an increase in the display of the life and power of Jesus. I'm tired of talking to a bunch of people that got a religious wall between me and them. Father, you said I could do greater works. Jesus, you said I could do greater works. I want to cut that. I want to cut right. Give me something, Lord, that will melt that bubble, that will cut right through that thick thing. Hallelujah. I was preaching, ministering in a place. Hallelujah. And there was a preacher, been in ministry 30 years. He was sitting right there. Every meeting, he sat right there, and his wife sat right beside him. And every meeting, he sat there with his arms crossed and his bottom lip sticking out. He didn't like a single word I said. Not a single word I said. Every meeting, I would just basically come and stand right here so I didn't have to address what was going on in his life. Hallelujah. And I never looked at him. I just looked over time. Because if I looked at somebody too long, I'd get compelled to say what's going on inside. I get compelled. It starts pulling me away. Hallelujah. Tatereneshe. You know, some of you, you've been around me long enough, you sit here and you ask questions and I'll answer them. Is that true?
Yeah.
It's true. It happens everywhere I go. You start asking questions and I start answering them because you're asking me to sit here and start asking some little stupid question. And I'll tell you right now, God, the Holy Ghost ain't going to respond. But I'm talking about questions you asking directly to God. Hallelujah. And so I just, you know, praise God for the gifts. I love the gifts of the Spirit. At any rate, hallelujah. Hallelujah. And then by the second meeting, or the third meeting, I believe it was, the rumor was getting around of how he just disliked me. And how could they invite me? And how was I vetted? You know what I'm saying? Hallelujah. That big old bottom lip sticking out, them arms off folded, like that's going to somehow influence me in a negative way. Man, that's just, I tell you right now, it influences me in a positive way. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Then I watched as he melted. Fourth meeting, I watched as he melted, began to weep. His wife been in pain for over 20 years, completely, totally healed. Huh? I never even stared at him. All their problems were melted. And then he comes to me, and the power of God had just hit the, it was the fourth night. And the power of God had hit just most everybody in the place. It was one of those things, you're just camping around the anointing and camping around the Word of God and the Spirit of God. You're going to get yourself a breakthrough, I'm telling you. And he comes to me and says, listen, I just got to repent. I just got to ask for forgiveness. I said, so tell me what's up. He said, I used to move in the gifts of the Spirit. He co-pastored one of the large churches in the United States of America up in Minnesota. He said, I used to move in the gifts of the Spirit. And he said, I backed away. I looked at him and said, okay, you're forgiven now, flow. Beautiful thing, man. Would watch that. He just went around and started giving words of knowledge over everybody. He was so drunk. He was like, he didn't know he was staggering, and he didn't know he was stirring. And then I'm, and he's just going after it. Because it was a missions conference, and there was all a bunch of missionaries and leaders there. He's prophesying over everybody. I love God just melting. Just melting the hardest heart. The most defiant look. If I can just keep him in the meetings. If I just get him to come, he had to come back because he was on staff. That's the only reason he came back. He had to be there. It was mandatory. Hallelujah. Just make it mandatory for yourself to be in the meetings. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Ha 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 ha. And some people just got to make it up, and other people just flow in it. And you see what I'm saying? I want you to advance from the ha 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 to it just actually come flooding out of you. It's available right now. The joy, the love, the peace, the goodness, the baptism in the glory. Don't have to close your eyes and try hard. Don't strain. He sends his word and heals you. He sent his word and redeemed you. Listen, Jesus said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he's anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. To bind up the broken heart, to proclaim liberty to the captive, the open of prison doors to them that are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. He didn't go around interviewing people and asking them if they would want to be set free. He freed everyone. Now they're all wandering around out on the streets wondering what they're going to do. Who opened your eyes? I don't know. Here's what he did. I don't know who he is, but he just put mud in my eyes and told me to go wash in the pool of Siloam. I was born blind. Now I see. Huh? This is it. This is the Lord. He just, gives you suramate right now. You don't have to earn nothing with God. There's no way you could ever be deserving of what he gives as a free gift. Listen to me right now. If you somehow got to measure up in your own understanding to what God has made available, you'll never have it. It is what Father has freely given to anybody, whosoever will. I love it. I love seeing people born of the Spirit and sincere in a true heart come sit in the meetings by the Word of God, just broken, contrite before him, just feeding on every good thing that comes from his word and by his spirit. And just the growth, it's just wonderful. Now all we got to do is just run off the wolves, come try to devour you. Huh? Now all we got to do is equip you how to take the helmet of salvation. Hallelujah. How to have your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel. Huh? Were you always prepared? You always flowing. And you just an evangel. You a fire, a flame that burns by the power of the living God. Huh? Your loins, that which is creative in you, is girt about with truth, the truth of his word. Praise the name, because the spirit of truth is on the inside of you, and you love truth and want to walk in truth. Praise the name of the living God. Huh? This is how you get strong. This is how you get strengthened. This is how you have an open door of entrance into understanding how to flow in all the gifts of the Spirit and all the workings of the power of God. Because you give all diligence to making your calling election sure, lowliness and meekness and virtue and the knowledge of God and temperance and godliness and brotherly kindness is all precious to you. And you give yourself completely, continually to in every way being made perfect in it, to being perfected in it, to fully maturing in it, to getting it perfect. Huh? Lord, I want to get humility perfect. Hallelujah. You know, getting humility perfect don't come easy. Do you understand what I just said? Getting humility perfect don't come easy. It's going to come hard. You understand what I'm saying? Because it's going to confront you. Huh? The retaliate button is going to be pushed. Okay. Hallelujah. Are you listening to me? Yeah. Hallelujah. When I'm going up to get into our gate, I start pushing that button. My wife says, why don't you just push it one time or just push and hold it? No, I'm going to make sure it happens as quick as possible. But the Spirit of the Lord, having given yourself over to walking in this divine goodness, to walking in his righteousness, hallelujah. Say, I am.
I am.
The righteousness of God.
The righteousness of God.
I'm empowered.
To walk in His righteousness.
To be righteous. Even as He is righteous.
As He is.
So am I.
So am I.
In this world. Hallelujah. Yeah. Praise the name of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. That's one. Hallelujah. I want to close. How many of you are sita? How many dokoraniya? How many security of you? How many are stutoramaya? Just need an interpreter. How many of you have found this place in the Lord where you can lose the English language every day? How many of you? Just a renatist. Where the mokea? Well, you can't speak in English if you tried. It's heaven. It's heavenly. I was caught away the other morning, doing some things out on the ranch. And then the Spirit of the Lord took me over. And I was caught away in the Holy Ghost. And the prayer is just flowing. I lost the English language. My son was walking down through the woods in the mountain. And he could hear it, but he didn't know what was going on. All he could hear. So I had gone back in the house, got some things, and I come back out and I see him walk across the field. And I was working on some stuff. He said, "Dad, were you out here praying?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "I don't know. I thought I was in heaven. Just the heavenlies was filling the place." That's the voice. That's the voice of God. That's the voice of the Father. God, the Holy Spirit wants to begin to speak through you and I on such a level and such a volume that our normal everyday hellos become the sound of heaven, become like lightnings that strike the hearts of men. Become the sound of God's divine power and grace that reproves the world of sin. Just speaking out a good day. And you see them busted and broken and begin to weep. You see somebody begin to be broken and begin to weep and begin to tremble. Move in. It's like the leaves trembling. Attack. Move in. Hallelujah. Come on, if we're pressing in for this and we want this in our life, God will do it. This is His will. This is His desire. These are the kinds of things, if we ask, He will do them. We're saying, "Father, I want a greater anointing, a greater display of Your power through my life." I'm going to tell you, Satan comes to try to shut it down by creating within your mind some lust, some evil desire, some wicked thought, some shame, some guilt, some separation, some condemnation, some distraction with earthly things and selfish interests, keeping you from being able to flow over in this divine power. But there is a place called rapture. There's a place called caught away. There's a place called walking in the Spirit. There's a place called living in God. I'm telling you right now, that begins to show forth the majesty and the splendor and the beauty of Almighty God in our life. Out the sound of our voice aren't like, it's not like fingernails on a chalkboard anymore. Oh, it's joy. It's a sound of joy and rejoicing and power and glory. Don't sell your soul for that which is cheap. Don't sell your soul for that which does not profit. God has given you the privilege to step up to a place of those who are the mighty ones, of those filled with His glory and His honor and His splendor. And it should demand all of our attention. And it's only right that we give it. Because it's true riches. It's a treasure and a gift that goes beyond all that we could ever think or ask. Dear people, I pray today, as we said starting the meeting, that every mind-blinding spirit, that every distraction and lie of hell has kept you from moving on with God, that has kept you from knowing that you stand in the company of the mighty right now, that all around you is the glory of heaven, that Father earnestly desires to walk with you and earnestly desires to empower you, pleads with you to forsake the things that are standing in the way, that are not His way, that there can begin to be
a strong and bold witness of that which took place when Jesus raised from the dead. When God raised Jesus from the dead. The same Spirit that raised God, Christ Jesus, from the dead dwells in me. The same Spirit that raised God, Christ Jesus, from the dead dwells in you. It's about time we let Him take over instead of allowing self to reign and dominate our life, doing our own thing, in other words, fulfilling our own interest. Jesus could have done His will and done His interest, but He said, I will not. I'm going to live to do the will of the Father. I'm not going to do anything that myself or for myself and or by myself or of myself. He's looking for you and I to follow Him. It's a disciplined life. Hallelujah. But it's a disciplined life on the level of relationship, of being married to somebody you just love. That you love. You love so much you can't stand to be without Him. I had to leave Ann behind. I left Ann in just so that we could be, really, just by and large, just because we just, every way we possibly can, we just being frugal with finances. And it's not necessary, we don't do it. But man, I'll tell you right now, I said, Lord, I was 1 hour out from the ranch. I said, Lord, it is now necessary. I'm so in love. It's a discipline of love. Come on, you listen to me. We want you to move past all the other stuff. Get over here into this relationship of love. Now, then you won't want to break His heart. Then you don't want to commit high treason against the Most High. Then you're not ignorant anymore and willing to bow to demon spirits. On the road to my house this morning when I flew in an airplane, I saw a young man in front of his motorcycle, down on his knees, his hands behind his head, he was being arrested. He could have found a place to bow before Jesus and have never been in whatever mess he was in. But I'm going to tell you right now, Satan, his purpose, that you bow to him. And we can see it over and again in life. We see it in the stories of the three Hebrew children when Nebuchadnezzar commanded the servants of the Lord to bow to his idols. Too many of God's people are willingly bowing their knee to the realms of darkness. I pray today in the name of Jesus you'll begin to fall in love with him. I pray in the name of Jesus you'll begin to let the Spirit of the Lord pour into you all the things of truth in life. Begin to so enjoy his presence. I so enjoy his presence. I never want to live. You know, kandabataki asapondo. Sundereke resistan. Come sometimes stronger than at other times. I want to come strong all the time. Sometimes I'm in a place and I'll just begin to sob. I'll begin to weep. It's not sorrow. I just come under such an influence of divine compassion and miracles flow. It doesn't matter what happens. What's going on? We got miracles in the house. When that compassion sweeps the soul like that, I want to be raptured that way all the time. When that's done, like when some heavenly thing is done, I'm like, oh Father, please show me how to live in this all the time. I don't want to live in something less than this all the time. I'm so desperate for you. I'm so hungry for you. This is how Father produces such desperation and hunger, so that we will not mishandle that which is sacred, so we will not make that which is holy common or profane it. For too many people have taken the sacred and the holy, and they've ended terribly. They've profaned His name. Oh, let God produce within us the heart of those who take a hold of the inheritance. Let God produce within us a Joshua spirit, as it were, which is far more than a Joshua spirit, because we have the Holy Ghost. And I should really rather say, because, you know, so we still have the right to choose. But there was something about Joshua in his individual personal right to choose where he yielded to that gifting that God had given him. And that's what I mean when I say the Joshua spirit. I use it loosely because, once again, we have the Spirit of Jesus Christ, but yet we still have the right to choose. And I look at Joshua and I see a man who wasn't baptized in the Holy Ghost. He received just a little bit. God told Moses to take some of the honor that he had received and place it upon Joshua.
And Joshua lives in the greatness and the splendor of divine power and glory. And at the end, listen to how he finished. As for me and my house, we serve the Lord. Choose this day whom you will serve. And he watched as so many people, they never got it. They never got it. The glory was all around them, but it was never beautiful to them, never wonderful to them. He was captivated. I'm captivated. I'm speaking out of this realm of the cloud of his glory and say, come. He wants to captivate you, but you're going to have to quit going a whoring after the things of demons. You have to quit going a whoring after the lust of this world. Listen to me. When you decide that it no longer exists to you, you're dead to sin and alive unto God. When you recognize you're dead unto sin and alive unto righteousness. When you recognize the gift of salvation, the gift of his righteousness that has come, and the joy of the communion and the fellowship with heaven. Come on, man. This is bigger than anything Satan can throw at you. You'll be right there in the throes of temptation where it comes upon you like you can't even say no. It's like everything, as it were, that you know desires this. And you go, Father, I desire you more. Your anointing is your loving kindness, your glory, your presence is better than all things, better than life to me. That's the love language. That's a love conversation that begins to take you into, hallelujah, a deeper revelation. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. God the Father, God Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, finds himself down on his knees before you, pleading with you to receive all his glory and all his goodness. It's hard to even imagine, isn't it? While we snub our nose towards him in many ways, I'm talking about the church as a whole. I'm not necessarily talking about anybody in here. But I pray in Jesus' name that every person, that I break off the yoke. You must understand, there's a yoke. If there's still a desire for sin in your life, there is a yoke. You've been yoked. You've been yoked like an ox by a demon spirit. Yoked. It is a yoke that is about your neck so that you can't turn apart by your own will, but you turn by the reign of the master. I break off that yoke. I'm going to confront that yoke here today. I break off that yoke so that no longer do you have to live under the bondage and slavery of an evil taskmaster with a desire in your heart for iniquity. God, in his loving kindness, gives us a desire in our heart for purity and for righteousness. If you don't have that desire in your heart today, you've never been born again. And unless you're born again, you cannot come into the kingdom. Can't know the kingdom, can't understand the kingdom. The things of the kingdom of God are foolishness to you. But if you'll let Father come and with his miraculous grace change you, he'll put within your heart a love for righteousness and a hatred for iniquity. He'll teach you obedience. He'll give you the gift of righteousness that you may learn how to walk in it. And there will be the Spirit of the Son there crying out from the inside of you that God is your dad. There will be the pleadings of the Holy Spirit on the inside of you, pleading and interceding for you with groanings which cannot be uttered, deep longings, deep hungers, deep thirsting, where you'll not want sin. If you do it, you won't. If you trip up in iniquity, you won't lay in it. There won't be a heart and a decision that says, I want to backslide. I want to go and do these other things. You listen to me. Yes. Today, God wants to break off the yoke. There's people in here today, you have a yoke on you. It's the yoke of slavery to death. You're a slave to death. Maybe you're watching me by the web or on YouTube right now. You're a slave to sin. The all-powerful name of Jesus is the only authority that can break off that yoke. And that name, by faith in his name, breaks the yoke now from off your life. The power of the Holy Ghost is here to change everything about the way you view life. Here to change you. Everything that you know in every way that you think, you'll never think or know things the same ever again. You'll learn how to think differently. All that you've known up to this point is nothing but garbage, lies. And you no longer go back to it. Hallelujah. Romans chapter 10, closing here, Romans chapter 10. Paul says concerning Israel, for they being ignorant of God's righteousness. Paul earnestly sought the righteousness of God through mitzvot, as many Jews do today, through just doing good deeds, that somehow through enough good deeds, through enough reading of the word, and contemplating the word, and reciting the word, and praying, and crying out, and humbling themselves, that somehow they might be able to be drawn just a little bit closer, not to see him face to face, but maybe just the outer envelope of his glory. But there on the road to Damascus, he had an encounter with Christ Jesus. And that moment in time, he beheld the righteousness of God and received as a free gift all that God had, which mitzvot and works and deeds could never attain. He became one with Father, became one with Christ Jesus. He became one with the Holy Ghost. And here he pleads in this context, saying, they're being ignorant of God's righteousness, speaking of the gift of righteousness that would be given to anyone who would believe, and going about to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God. I'm going to ask you, have you submitted yourself unto the righteousness of God? His name is the Holy Ghost. You submit yourself unto the righteousness of God? His name is Jesus. Have you submitted yourself unto the righteousness of God? Now doing those things which belong to righteousness, you love his ways. Hallelujah. Now finding yourself righteous even as he's righteous. That doesn't belong to those who want to continue on in sin. There are people who try to utilize that and they continue on in sin, just act like, you know, they can have sin in their life and say that they the righteousness of God, that they're righteous even as he's righteous. Not only is that not logical, that's damnable heresy. That is so far from anything that is truth, because the Spirit of righteousness, God the Holy Ghost, lives on the inside of us to teach us the ways of life. It's like people saying, I love life, but I'd rather do death. I got life, but I want to continue on in death. It's not even logical. I've got righteousness, but I want to continue on in sin. I have God's righteousness, but I like sin. But that's not even sensible. Much less that which God's word has spoken forth to create within you and me. Such a glorious thing. Such a glorious liberty of the sons of God. I want you to stand with me. Turn up, if you're going to play, turn up just a bit. Yeah, just come, Crystal, come. You're on. You. And so, when we talk about the righteousness of God, we're talking about the righteousness which is by faith. Somebody said, tell me what the righteousness is by faith. Let me tell you what it is. Faith equals being born again. The righteousness which is by being born again. It's just like, tell me what salvation is. It equals the washing of water of regeneration. The washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost. People want to make the faith something that we just cross our fingers and hope for and believe without any proofs. That's nonsense. It's the new creation. The Spirit of the Lord comes upon you, makes you a new creation by calling upon the name of the Lord Jesus. The act of divine grace that is given to us through what Jesus did for us because of who Jesus is. By the power of his resurrection. By the authority of his word. That's the faith. So the righteousness which is by faith says this. Don't say in your heart, who shall ascend into heaven? God said to Israel, literally, he said this in Deuteronomy, said, I have put my word in your mouth. That you may keep it, you may speak it, and that you may keep it. Say not in your heart, who shall ascend into heaven to bring it down? Paul takes that up right here. But he takes it beyond just what God audibly spoke with his voice from the midst of the fire. He takes it to the place of what Father has done in our heart when we were given the righteousness of God. How? Through Christ Jesus, who knew no sin but became the sin offering. That by him bearing our sin on the tree. Listen to me. If you came to Jesus under false pretense, I want to sort you out today. If you did not come to Jesus recognizing that you are crucified together with him, that you came to be killed, to die, to live no longer, you came on false pretense. When you came to Jesus to call upon his name, you were buried with him by baptism into his death. And if you weren't, you came on false pretense. If you didn't come saying, I'm no longer spending my life in the realms of sin and iniquity to participate with sin and death, you came on false pretense. When you come to Jesus, you come to be crucified, to be buried with him, and to be raised up together with him, to have a new life, to be taught to live a new life. When you come to Jesus, you're coming to say, the life that I've lived is going to be destroyed at this very moment. I want it destroyed. I want it put to death. And I want his life. I want a new life. And I want to be taught by God how to live out this life. That's what he's saying. That's what he's saying here. He says, verse 8, this word of faith, this righteousness which is by faith, this word is near to you. It's in your mouth and it's in your heart. This is the word of faith which we preach. That if you would just confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is your master, that Jesus Christ is your ruler. Ruler. Rule. He rules you. If you confess that Jesus Christ is your ruler, that he's God, he's Lord, and he's your ruler, and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be washed with the water of regeneration and renewed with the Holy Ghost. For with your heart you believe unto righteousness. You believe unto a brand new life. You believe that old things are passed away, and behold, all things are new. And now all things are of God. You believe in your heart that you're a new creation. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If any man be in Christ Jesus, he's a new creation. You believe that you're a new creation, that you're made after his likeness and after his image, after righteousness and true holiness. Listen to me. Sin will make you everything unlike God. Men had become so corrupted in their ways and had become so unlike God in 1565 years that God was grieved and repented that he ever made man. Satan had made them so like him and so unlike God. I pray today that you get yourself some wisdom. I pray today in the name of Jesus Christ, you begin to understand this amazing grace, this glorious gift. Thank you, Jesus. You got to come clean, man. You have to come clean with God. There's people in this place. You need to come clean with God. You need to come clean with God. You stand before him naked. See, the word of God is living, is powerful. Sharper than any two-edged sword. Divides soul from spirit, joint from marrow, and is a discerner of the thought and the intent of the heart, what the heart contemplates to do in the future. The intent of the heart. Oh, tokoma seteya pakaya. Why don't you just stretch your hands forth before the Lord to today and just surrender yourself completely to Him. Just surrender yourself completely before Jesus. Just surrender yourself to Him. Just surrender yourself to Him. Thank you, Jesus. Just surrender yourself completely to Him. God, the Holy Ghost is here to lead you and to guide you and to teach you, to empower you and to strengthen you. Hallelujah. I want to invite anybody in this place to say, hey, you have any question about your salvation? You have any question whatsoever about your walk with God? I want to invite you to a place where you not have a question ever again. Those of you who find yourself living contrary to the ways of God, and you've not found the power and the strength to obey God, we want to invite you today to find that power and that strength. Whether you're here in the building, watching by the web or YouTube, we're inviting you right now. God is inviting you. This is not religion. This is not something that just is what happens in church. This is God from heaven speaking to you, Christ Jesus from heaven calling out to you. This is change of life. This is a change of understanding. This is the ability to receive from heaven. I know there's some people in here that you have some sickness and pain in your body. God, the Lord Jesus Christ, going to touch that here today too. But more important to Him is your insides, the state of your heart. More important to Him is the state of your thoughts, the state of your life, than your body. Jesus. Jesus. Somebody said, well, I want to serve God. I haven't found the strength. Today, we want you to find the strength. Somebody said, I delight to do God's will, but within me is no good thing. Today, we want a good thing to be born on the inside of you. Hallelujah. 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 Those of you, there's people in here who live in depression. Joy is not your state. Joy and love isn't the state of your existence. There's people who live here in sorrow and depression. It's hard for you to be happy. God wants to change that. God, the Holy Ghost, wants to change that. Let Him change you right there where you're standing. Let Him change you. Let Him touch you. Let Him deliver you. Let Him set you free. There's probably going to be, for some of you who've been in the church for a while, if you've got any of those things going on, there's going to be some repentance. There's going to be some things that you've done. There's going to be some spiritual violations going on in your life. And the floodlight of heaven shining on your soul right now to show you exactly where you've gone wrong. And all you got to do is repent. All you got to do is confess it. And He's faithful and just to forgive you, cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Confess it. Confess your sin. Confess the things that you've done that are not right with God, that are contrary to His way. Confess the spiritual violations. You know what God's going to do? He's going to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Hallelujah. And when you cleanse from all unrighteousness, guess what you are? Righteous. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise the name of Jesus. Anybody you want prayer for anything, especially in the things that I've named. You've not found strength to overcome. You've not found the strength to walk with God. Come on, I'll pray with you and for you. The Lord will touch you. He's going to come if I'm calling for somebody that's pregnant. He's found the strength. He's just hungry. And I just pray in the name of Jesus, every one of you just get so hungry for the things of heaven. Hallelujah. God's got a great life for you. Father's planned out an extremely, extreme, glorious life for you. Just raise your hands for a second. I said, Father's planned out an extreme, glorious life for you. If you got pain in your body, you're sick in your body, I want you to come. Pain in your body, sick in your body, I want you to come. I want you to come and be healed. Just like if I invited you to come and be saved, I want you to come and be healed. You know, I look out across this audience this morning and I recognize that everybody in this place at some point in time, you've called upon the name of the Lord Jesus. I'm going to tell you right now, I can see and also know that some of you, since you've called upon the name of Jesus, you've not been baptized in water, and we want to take you to the water and baptize you. And I know we just had a water baptism, but some of you missed it. We want you to obey God, go all the way with God. Don't go part way, go all the way with God. In the name of Jesus, some of you standing in here, you've not been baptized in the Holy Ghost. Now, in Jesus' name, you get yourself baptized right now. Somebody said, I'm waiting on God. No, you're not. Because baptism all over the place. Baptism all over you right now. God poured out a spirit upon all flesh. You would have to not be flesh to be in this place. You would have to be stone or wood or something. Huh? To not have the Holy Ghost all over you right now. Hallelujah. God, not my shayte, God, not my shaya. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your healing power. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I break off the yoke. I break off the yoke. Everybody that's got arm problems, come to the center. Everybody that's got shoulder problems, come right over here to the center. Everyone with shoulder problems, come to the center. Huh? And just lift your hands towards you. You're going to get these things healed. You get those things healed in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Father, we thank you for the miracle right now. Hallelujah. Thank you. Just keep those shoulders. Just keep Borosate. Monderest. Morosteya. Jesirinath. Jesiradith. Jesikadasht. What's up? What's up?
Jesus.
Jesus. Jesus. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, this pain goes out of your body, goes out of your head. What's up? What's wrong? In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I command the sickness and this affliction to go off your body right now in Jesus' name. Off your body. Now in Jesus' name. Now in Jesus' name. What's wrong with you?
I have a exam. That's
huh?
I just want to feel
you have what?
Exam.
Oh. Well, I just command you to be blessed. In Jesus' name. What do you need?
Migraines.
You have a migraine right now? But they come on you.
All the time.
They come on you all the time. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, look at me. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I break that affliction off of your body. In Jesus' name. Tarabositefe. Tarastakitili. Now in Jesus' name. Now in Jesus' name. Now in Jesus' name. Landerastiotu. Now in Jesus' name. Your body begins to function normally. In Jesus' name. Be healthy. Be healthy.
Stretch your hands towards heaven. Let the Lord touch you.
See, what you're reaching for, what I'm reaching for, is the realms of the anointing touch you. Hallelujah. The anointing touches you, you get healed every time. Amen. But I just tell you right now in Jesus' name, no more headaches. No more migraines. In the name of Jesus, I speak into your spirit by the Spirit of the Lord an assurance.
No more migraines.
No more migraines. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Right out of your belly begins to flow these rivers of the Holy Ghost. The utterances of heaven. The utterances of the Spirit of God. They all begin to speak with the heavenly language as the Holy Ghost gave them utterance. Mandea, rivers. Rivers from on high. It comes simply by drinking. Sidoropo, of the water which Jesus supplies. Mandea, sheotira. Nera sutast. My best. Now in Jesus' name. Now in Jesus' name. Now in Jesus' name. Ripefa. Ripefetisht. Ripefetishti. 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 Ripefetosato. Managresti feast. What's up, baby?
No more throwing up.
Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Mondate. Mondate. Monstikia ratest. Monstikia. Jesus' name.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. Jesus' name. What do you need?
Stronger hunger for the Lord.
Yeah.
Pray for my baby.
Okay. Father, we thank you for that you put hunger on the inside of us. We don't. We can't even be the producers of our own hunger. But Lord, you put hunger on the inside of us because you allow us to encounter your glory and your goodness. So right now, in the name of Jesus, baby touch right now. Mozataya. Banglekaha. Ha ha. Bandala shikaro. Maleo tahai. Ha. Mandea sisia tedus. Evrata sikisti. Molara. Molara beas. Morada besti brevekist. Come pray with Bernie for me, will you? Jesus. Right now. Right now. Right now. Baptizer. Baptized. Matuyare. Now, in Jesus' name. Mambambrist. Miembrekeosh. It's time. It's time. Mundest. Mundest. Brist. Ast. List. Ar. Ith. Ith. Istutat. Istutat. Baxtia. Sust. Morast. My friends. Now. Now, in Jesus' name. Now. 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 Jesus. 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 Jesus.
Jesus.
Lord Jesus.
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 Every torment of the thoughts and of the mind, I break the power of the thing off of you now, Jesus' name. Be girded about with truth. Right now, in the name of Jesus, every hurt, everything of the past, broken off of you now, in Jesus' name. Now, in Jesus' name. Brasto te de geste e bakto ki ranan jestu. That the Ferisotai, that the Fetarosika, that the rivers of heaven right now, that the rivers of God's goodness and glory begin to flow out of you with greater force, with greater force.
with greater force. Greater
force.
Yeah. Yeah. Father, just thank you. Do it now.
No, Lord.
Do it now. 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 Do it now, Lord.
Do it now, Lord.
Do it now. Right now. Now. Do it now, Father. Do it now. Do it now. Do it now. Do it now. Borasagate ethist. Those of you who have arm, shoulder problems, just arm problems, just begin to work it right now. I'm coming that way. Because you're going to release your faith into the thing. And I'm just going to hook up with your faith, and it's going to be done, in Jesus' name. Jesus. What do you want?
Just establishing the faith.
Well, you are establishing the faith. What do you mean?
Just to be, just have it very consistent.
Okay. Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
So really what you're just saying is you just want to learn how to walk in the Holy Ghost all the time.
Amen.
It's really pretty easy. Just walk in the Spirit. Just walk in. Just yield yourself to God, the Holy Ghost. He teach you how. That's what he's come to do. What's wrong, dear Brad?
My arm.
What's wrong with your arm?
It's all tight and sore.
What, from what?
Probably banging on stuff.
Jesus. Lord Jesus. Take this pain away right now. Heal this muscle tissue right now, Father, I pray. Touch Brad from the crown of his head to the soles of his feet. Just give me your arm. Well, I don't know if you can feel that, but I can feel that. What you want? Winter?
Yes.
What you want? And what does it cause? What's your problem?
It causes pain.
Oh, just pain in your foot? Well, that's just hectic. That is not even right. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, look at me. In the name of Jesus, I command the pain go out of your body. It has to obey me. I don't see any question mark in your eyes. You have to obey. As soon as somebody gets to the point that they have to obey, they get healed. You know what I'm saying? That's just the reward of obeying. Thank you, Jesus. The first time that Winter came to the meeting back in 2011 or something like that, it was, the Lord broke all the addictions off of her life. First meeting. Hey? It says what the speed of Dara Mosatai. What do you want?
Infection in my nasals, infection on my skin. and deeper in the Holy Ghost.
Okay. Threefold.
Three,
what does that
three
mean?
Three things.
Oh, threefold. Okay. I got you. Father, thank you for your loving kindness and your tender mercies. In the name of Jesus Christ, from the crown of your head to the soles of your feet, be healed. Be healed. Just be healed. Be healed. Be healed. I break every affliction and torment off your body now and off your mind. In Jesus' name. What's up? Your shoulder?
Shoulder, neck. It's kind of like reoccurring.
Father, we thank you right now for your healing anointing. Heal the tissue, Father, in Jesus' name.
Surrender everything about my life again, Master.
Okay. That's what's most important. Thank you, Jesus. From the crown of your head to the soles of your feet, I paint you with the blood of Jesus. But now, by the power that is in the name of Jesus, be healed. Be healed. Be healed. Be healed in your spirit. Healed your body. What's wrong now?
Every now and then I get a pain on one of my.
You got any pain now? Okay, just lift your hands towards heaven. I know you want everything. Father, your servants are hungry for you. And I ask you to take this life and fully use them in a radical way, stepping beyond all that is natural, all that is normal, to find himself completely in that which you create, oh God, when you create everything. What's up?
Yeah, my shoulder.
Well, how's it doing? Well, how are you doing now? Just keep working on it.
Shoulder.
Lift your hand. What's up?
I was always some drain pipe yesterday. And one of the guys fell and took all the weight on my shoulder.
He did. I command the shoulder to be healed in Jesus' name. I command this shoulder to be healed in Jesus' name. Jesus' name. I command it's a call to die. Shoulder.
Basically, chest congestion.
Congestion?
Yes.
Well, you know what? I don't like this shoulder, this rotator cuff being all messed up. Actually, I want to jerk you around.
Okay.
To be very honest with you. In a good way. I don't want to jerk you around in a bad way. I know that's a very negative phrase. I want to grab your arm and command it and whip it into shape, okay? And say, listen. From the crown of your head to the soles of your feet, God's blessing is upon you. God's grace is upon you. There's not a bit of reason for you to be in anything other than perfect health.
Yes, Lord.
And this affliction, this torment has come against your body, from the infection in your lungs and your sinuses to the tissue problems that you have in your feet and your hip and your legs and your shoulder. Is it all down the right side or is it on the left side too?
It's just the left side.
The left side. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Be healed. In Jesus' name. I command you to be healed, in Jesus' name. Is she still having problems with your shoulder?
No.
Where? And you,
it's like my funny bone.
Yeah.
Shoots up, down, and shoots up, and then my.
Just without touching it.
No,
it's
all the time.
Just all the time.
It's
it is right now.
I'm hitting my funny bone all the time. Mm-hmm.
So. And is that way right now?
Jesus.
Is it that way? Is that way right now? Lucy, look at me. There's enough anointing here to raise the dead. I mean, I'm telling you, there's enough anointing here like raise the dead. I command this funny bone to be healed.
Thank you.
in Jesus' name.
It's gone. It's gone.
Your pain and affliction. Your pain and affliction. Laristate. Laristate. Sutaromoste. Kili mandebre. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Lord, we thank you for a great gift of healing. The gifts of healing. And the working of miracles in your daughter's life. Sit down today. That every word of her that comes forth from her mouth is a creative miracle at work. See utterances of heaven to her soul. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Marasa teyest. Marasa tefrete. Marasa tefrete. Do this now, Lord. Do this now. Command this. I command this tissue problem, this affliction and this pain to cease to exist. Now in Jesus' name. Now in Jesus' name. Manaki tu anaseke ipotopa anipi. Su uturama ixtiolama usteparanipitila. Brefeti probo sutorebeteste vitla. Sutora musikita deste. That no affliction of any sort or any type can cleave unto this body, or can cleave unto this heart, or the soul, or the spirit. In Jesus' name. Brasatiki daranama kupre nikishtipila. Efratina moshika. Eprefina na moshika rotosti. Balastu turinika. Nanamase peliotopo. Maliastu totodolomo piti alono. Thank you, Father, for working this miracle now. Thank you, Father, for working this miracle now, in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Emane Deya Tumosh. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, living God. Presence like oil over me, Lord. Like water over me, oh God. Healing, cleansing. Water over my soul, my spirit, and my body. Fresh oil upon me. Great faith now. Great faith now. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Mama Nangajaya. With nothing to prove and everything to receive. Hallelujah. With nothing to prove to anyone ever. Frees us up to just receive everything. Hallelujah. Hamangate esito robokeya. Etesekude de fe ixtia tuluya. Mondande ereste. Give me your arm. What's your problem?
Problem is, it hurts when I like pitch or like throw football type stuff.
Just be healed.
Amen.
In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. I haven't really been concerned about how you throw the football. I've been more concerned about how you flow in joy. I've been a little bit more concerned about how well the overflow works in your life. Let's say. I've been concerned about that. Hallelujah. Like there's some kind of restriction on the valve or something. I'll sit there today. In Jesus' name.
Why don't you lift both hands real high? Why don't you just go ahead and receive? Why don't you just go ahead and flow in the Holy Ghost? Why don't you just go ahead and go with the Father? Why don't you just go ahead and get baptized in the Holy Ghost? I said, why don't you go ahead and just get baptized in the Holy Ghost? Seeing as he's all around you, why don't you just go ahead and get baptized in the Holy Ghost? I say, go ahead. Go right ahead. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hey, kind of day. Just get say to Rashi. Mandaya. Lucy, how's your arm? How's your elbow? Well, we don't want better. So, Father, we thank you that Lucy's going to walk out of this place here today. She's not going to have this pain no more. In the name of Jesus, it's not going to just be better. It's going to be completely healed. I break off that affliction. I break it off, the affliction. I break the thing off in Jesus' name. Is there any migraine to be found over here?
Right here, there's one spot left.
We're going to have all spots go. I command it so. In the name of Jesus Christ, open me. Hallelujah. Jesus' name. Hallelujah. 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 Praise God. Hallelujah. Why don't you just come worship the Lord with your tithes and with your offerings? Just bless the Lord with that which Father has blessed you with so he can multiply it more. Go ahead and bless God with that which he's blessed you with so he can multiply it more. I said, go ahead and bless God with what he's blessed you with so he can multiply it more. I said, go ahead and obey God and bless God with what he's blessed you with so he can work a miracle for you, provision. Hallelujah. Just bless the Lord with your body and watch how your body just takes on a whole new dimension of living in divine health. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Baresto, kamakiteo, baresto, hallelujah.
This is the man that led me to Jesus.
Good. Spotara nasete kiste berefet. Molanda de enest. Molanda de este pe. Well, Lord, we just pray that he dies healthy.
Yes.
Instead of getting all off and all that stuff.
Yes.
Lord, when he dies, we pray he dies healthy. Hallelujah. Karashate. Likashate. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Maitreya. The Pesherita. Beklano. Just stupid. Slip your hands toward heaven. Close your eyes and forget where you're at. I go to give you something, you get all. If I could just sneak up on people, you know what I'm saying? Like you sneak up behind them, you spook them, right? Surprise them. We get everybody filled with every good thing. They see you coming, they get all braced. They're set. Hallelujah. Say toto to. Hallelujah. Whatever you want. What do you want? Huh?
I just want tongues. I just want to flow. I just want to flow.
And the flow of the Holy Ghost?
Yeah.
Well, go ahead. Receive. I break off this yoke from off of you. I break off the yoke from off of you that hinder you. Now, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I break off the yoke that would hinder you. Now that that's done with, go ahead. Go ahead. Go ahead. Right out of your belly flows. Lord, I ask you to come into Manny's life with this overflow of heaven like a rushing mighty wind. Lord, we don't want no little tickle. Lord, we want a rushing mighty wind with these clothing tongues of fire. A rushing moving of your spirit. Out of your belly flows the rivers of the Holy Ghost. This is what Jesus said for anybody who drinks. So Lord, I ask you, teach Manny right now how to drink. When you think about that, that's a pretty sad state. Don't even know how to drink. The reality of it is without him, we can do nothing. I didn't know how to drink either. The Lord had to teach me. No, 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 say ya. Look at me. I'm going to go beyond realms that you can even think about going. You can't even go there thinking it. Satukia, nasetrone esi, bakaya mositi ifi, nabaya romosikana se. Now in Jesus' name. Now in Jesus' name. Receive. Say this. Say it, Lord Jesus.
Lord Jesus.
Don't look at me. Just look to him now.
Okay.
Say, Lord Jesus.
Lord Jesus.
Come fill me.
Come fill me.
Say again.
Lord Jesus. Come fill me.
Say, I yield myself to you. Fill me, Lord. Just stay right there. Just keep saying that. And stop. Keep saying that. Stop. Stop. Ikara mamon zesi tiyatu. Ikara mamon usia ramamane. Ikara mamon shia ramamana geya. Ishiri amamamana zazeyaro. Mamanande risamba badakriyasi. Mi andanda amananjeo pusu. Mambravaya ki arava te esi alambufre de esi buyaya and mbakita lamumpra. Maramam, from the crown of your head to the soles of your feet, I take the blood of Jesus Christ and paint you right now.
with his wonderful work of redemption. Now in Jesus' name, be filled with the glory of heaven. Be overwhelmed with an encounter of his person. Be overwhelmed with the encounter. Be overwhelmed right now with the goodness of God, with his presence. So that you never want to leave this place. So that you never want to leave this place in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you for the miracles. We thank you for signs and wonders. We thank you for your healing power. We thank you, Father, that everybody in this place wants the things that you want to do in their life spiritually, even more than you want to do in their life physically. Huh? Look at me. No, you're not. Okay. I got you cured.
Okay.
Just be in church.
Okay.
Get in all the meetings.
Okay.
In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. No hindrance in your life. In Jesus' name, I break off everything that would try to hold you back. Everything that would try to afflict you and torment you. Look at me. Everything that would try to afflict you and torment you, I smash it. It now loses its hold from off you. Oh, yeah. Are you on your way to heaven? Huh?
Yes. I think so.
You think so? No, you got to know so. You got to know so. Have you been born again? Have you been born again? You have to be born again. How do you get born again? You call upon the name of the Lord Jesus. And God the Holy Ghost will come upon you and change your heart. Now we just believe. I got to just believe. And say it happens now. You turn your whole life over to Jesus. You're not in control anymore. Look at me. You're not going to be the master of your life anymore. You're not the one who's going to be deciding what you're going to do and what you're not going to do. Where you're going to go and where you're not going to go. How you're going to feel and how you're not going to feel. You're going to let Christ Jesus master your life. The Holy Ghost master your life. You're going to live by the Word. You're going to do what God's Word says to do. Huh? You're going to get out of this wheelchair. You're going to get healed. Walk around. Be strengthened. You're not going to deteriorate. How old are you? You're 76. That's not old. You don't look old either. Do you feel old? If you would have just stayed in church, you would have been. If you would have just stayed in church. But if you would have, it's gone forever. Okay? Now, today, from this day forward. I give you life. That's what Jesus says. I give you life. Now live it. The Lord Jesus gave us life and then we not live it. I mean, goodness, what profit is that? I'm going to live the life that he gave. And the Word of God describes to me the life that he gave. There's a lot of people say that they are, but they're not. They're just doing their own thing. You hear me? But you're not going to do that. You're not going to be that sort. So I command you to be healed. Command all your joints to work properly. Move them around. Move all your joints around. Look at me. Move all your joints around. Move all your bones. Get up and walk around a bit. Get up and walk around a little bit. Huh?
No.
I'm okay.
When you believe that you can walk around a little bit.
Oh, yeah.
I said, get up and walk around a little bit. He said, now? I said, no. As soon as you believe that you can get up and walk around a little bit. No, it's true. Because I'm just telling you out of the realms of the anointing of the Holy Ghost, but you've got to know, you've got to be willing to believe what God has said. And I'm not going to help you. I'm not going to allow anybody else to help you either. The only person who is allowed to help you is Jesus. Amen. Feel pretty good, don't you? Feel pretty good, don't you? Look at me. Feeling pretty good?
Yeah.
Feel pretty good, don't you?
Yeah.
Oh.
Huh? So you broke your hip?
Yeah.
I command your hip to be completely healed. Look at me. In Jesus' name, I break this affliction and torment off of your body. They would try to put you in the grave through that wheelchair. In Jesus' name. So you just start walking around. Start moving around. Start praising Him. Let me baptize you. Okay, I'm baptizing in water. So you get baptized in the Holy Ghost. Everybody, find a bunch of people around you. Hug them. Tell them that you love them. Bless them in Jesus' name. Bernie, Lord has touched you. Or just touched you more than I've ever seen happen. Believe it.